You're listening to the Vocabit podcast, where I help students improve their vocabulary for the SAT, ACT, and life itself using my unique and research-backed story-based method. On this podcast, I'm sharing the best tips and tricks for a more enriched vocabulary and pain-free test day. Hello, and welcome to episode number 29 of the Vocabit podcast. I'm Erica Abbott, a former English and history teacher, the author of the young adult novel Ahead of Her Time, and the founder of the eponymously named vocabulary company, Vocabit. Before we dive into the topic of today's show, I just want to remind you that today, June 23rd, is the last day to sign up for the 500 words in 50 days summer challenge at Vocabit. It is totally free for Vocabit members. You just have to email me to let me know you'd like to participate. And if you're not yet a Vocabit member, it's $15. And for those 50 days, you get access to everything in the Vocabit membership in addition to everything you need for the challenge. So it's a really amazing deal. You can sign up at vocabit.com/500words. But today, I want to talk to you about a subject that may be on your mind or may not be on your mind for another month yet. And that is summer reading. I don't think I realized how controversial a subject it is until last summer. I was in the waiting area to get my hair cut, and I was reading a book. Some guy asked me what it was, and I told him. I said, you know, it's called In the Sea, There Are Crocodiles. It's a good book. I'm tutoring some kids, and it's their summer reading. And this guy's energy changed so fast. He immediately just started going off on, you know, how horrible it is that teachers assign this stuff, and kids shouldn't have to read over the summer. And I mean, you would think that teachers had ordered kids to pull out their own toenails or something. Like it was just, he was so against it. And it was a bit of a shock to me because reading is one of the greatest joys of my life. There's an old quote that the world is a book and those who don't travel read only one page. And I totally agree with that, but I have my own little spin on that quote. And it's that those who don't read live only one life. I can't imagine how much less rich my life would be if I'd only lived in this time and place. Because of books, I feel like I've lived in Henry VIII's court, and I've been chased by lions in the Colosseum, and the list goes on and on. I recently read a summer reading book called Salt to the Sea, and it was so good. It opened my eyes to a really specific period of history that I didn't know much about. It's a World War II book, and it's about Operation Hannibal. Maybe you already know about it. I didn't. I'm not going to share more than what's on the back cover, but I want to talk to you about it for a second because it was so good. So near the end of World War II, the Germans basically refused to admit that they were going to lose. So as the Russians start pushing in from the east, millions of people who are under German occupation, like the Poles, we're essentially fighting a war on both sides. The Russians are invading from the east, but the Germans wouldn't let them evacuate to the west. And since we're talking about World War II, I probably don't have to remind you that killed is a nice way of putting what the Germans might do to you. And though Russian cruelty may have been less organized, they committed horrific war crimes also. And that would have been a gripping book on its own. People trying to get out before the Russians get there, but also having to dodge the Germans. But the story doesn't end there. At the very last second, the Germans did issue an evacuation order for certain people, you know, people with one German parent, things like that. They weren't going to save everyone, but they did issue evacuation orders eventually for certain people. But by that point, millions of people were surrounded. A lot of them had pushed north during that period of uncertainty because remember, the Germans wouldn't let them go to the west. The Russians are coming in from the east. So a lot of them ended up in the north along the coast of the Baltic Sea. And we've got our amazing characters who have fought their way to safety, fought their way to the coast of the Baltic Sea. And, you know, some of our characters aren't technically on the evacuation lists, but I won't give anything away on that front. But for the ones who make it aboard, you think that they're home free. Of course, it'll be an awful couple of days on this ship, the Gustloff, because the Germans had packed 10,000 people on a ship meant for 1,500. But I mean, after all they've experienced, they've made it, right? They're on an evacuation ship to safety. But the Gustloff, which was just one of the many ships that was part of this evacuation, sank. After all these people had been through, they were hit by Russian torpedoes. And it's actually considered the worst shipwreck in history. Almost 10,000 people died. As a comparison, around 1,500 people died on the Titanic, but almost no one knows about the Gustloff. the Nazis didn't want to publicize it because it would look bad. And with the war ending shortly thereafter, people just kind of had other things to talk about. This book, Salt to the Sea, was one of the best summer reading books I've read in a really long time. If it's on your summer reading list this summer, I highly recommend choosing this one. I know a lot of people have, you know, a list of 20 supplementary books that they can choose from. If it's on that list, I would definitely suggest this one. In addition to just being so well written and such an interesting plot, it also had a lot of really good SAT vocabulary words in it to help you continue getting those impressions that you need to kind of passively build your vocabulary. To be honest, I really wasn't paying attention to the vocabulary after the first couple pages because I was just so in the book. But I do remember at the very beginning seeing words like petulant, which, you know, means bad-tempered, kind of childish, and other words like that. But yeah, if you're interested in World War II, want to passively build your vocabulary, or even writing, there were so many things that this author did that were just such brilliant writing constructs. She brought the story full circle so well. It was just a really good book. Someday, I would love to put together kind of a Vocabit summer reading list. It would cull the best choices from all the most popular summer reading lists and give you books that are both good and also can boost your vocabulary. I think it would take a while to put together, though, because I would have to reread a lot of these books with an eye for vocabulary. But I can definitely see that happening in the future. And if you happen to read a summer reading book this summer that you think fits that bill, that's a good book and also has some good vocabulary words in it, definitely let me know about it because I'd love to check it out and maybe add it to the list. But in the meantime, if Salt to the Sea is on your summer reading list, I would definitely suggest it. It's not a book for younger kids. Let's make that clear. It is a World War II book, and there are definitely some adult subjects in it. But if it is suggested by your school as an option, it was one of the better summer reading books I've read in a long time. All right, I'll see you guys on Thursday.